Hello anatomy colleagues, this is Dr. Alsup, and in this video we will be discussing how bone formation actually occurs. So bone formation is called ossification. All right, so that is the correct terminology for bone formation, and we will talk about how that term differs from the term calcification, which those two terms are often used interchangeably, incorrectly of course. And there are two methods of ossification, and we will talk big picture in terms of those processes and which types of bone will form in these manners. So lots of fun stuff to talk about here, so let's get right into it. Okay, all bone formation begins with the formation of an embryonic skeleton composed of mesenchyme. All right, so you see this mesenchymal skeleton. And remember in our previous discussions, mesenchyme is an embryonic tissue that almost all connective tissues are derived from. And since bone is a type of connective tissue, that makes sense that it's going to form within a mesenchymal skeleton. This formation begins around the 6th week in utero, and from there, bone formation follows one of two patterns. So these two types of ossification are referred to as intramembranous ossification, as well as endochondral ossification. But before we get into the description of these, I want to focus on this question right here. Because the terms ossification and calcification are often used interchangeably, which is incorrect. These terms are not synonymous. Ossification, which is the focus of our video here, ossification is the process by which bone forms, and this can happen in four specific situations. It can happen with initial formation of bone, which is what we're going to discuss in detail here. Ossification also occurs with growth of bone during the juvenile period is complete, and then there'll be adult bone. Also remodeling of bone. And lastly, repair of bone. So those are going to be the four specific situations that ossification can occur. And as part of bone formation and ossification, osteoblasts, remember, will lay down that organic material, materials of the extracellular matrix, and that will initiate calcification or tissue hardening, okay? So if you think about what is making bone hard, it is going to be the calcification process. So calcification is a process within ossification. So make sure to not use these terms interchangeably. So calcification happens during ossification, but don't use those terms interchangeably. Okay, returning to the main types of ossification. The first one we are going to discuss is intramembranous ossification, which usually we start with this one because it's the simpler of the two. And in this process, bone will replace the mesenchymal skeleton directly. Whereas in endochondral ossification, the mesenchymal skeleton is replaced by a hyaline cartilage model, which itself will increase in size and then eventually be replaced by bone. So there is an extra step when we're talking about endochondral ossification. So let's explore the big picture ideas regarding the process of intramembranous ossification. And the first part I really want you to understand is this concept referred to as an ossification center. And ossification centers are areas where cells begin to kind of cluster together, which will eventually become areas that will develop into bone. So those cells will eventually differentiate into osteoblasts that will secrete extracellular matrix components of bone. So in the case of intramembranous ossification, first those mesenchymal cells will cluster together, and then those mesenchymal cells will differentiate into those osteogenic cells. And if you recall, the next point in that life cycle will be changing into the osteoblast. So they will kind of collect in this area. After this occurs and osteoblasts are hard at work, calcification or hardening of the extracellular matrix can occur. So here, right here, you have calcification being a process within ossification. Now the bone extracellular matrix will form the trabeculae, or those bony beams that you often see in spongy bone. And also during this time, red bone marrow will form around this area and kind of within these spaces between the trabeculae. And lastly, the periosteum will form on the outer surface of the bones. And additionally, the outer layer of spongy bone will be replaced by compact bone, because there always has to be that outer layer of compact bone, but the center of the bone typically stays mostly spongy. So only a minority of bones form through intramembranous ossification, and these include many of the flat bones of the skull, which are kind of that skull cap region. And between the bones of the skull, you will also have fontanelles, which I'm outlining a few in these images. You can have them in different areas of the skull. These fontanelles are often referred to as soft spots, particularly this anterior fontanelle is the soft spot. And these are important in allowing the large skull to exit the relatively small birth canal, so allowing some flexibility there. And after birth, these areas will undergo intramembranous ossification and harden and be replaced entirely by bone. Other bones that form through intramembranous ossification include many of the facial bones, as well as the mandible or your lower jaw, and the medial part of the clavicle. So when you look at this list, particularly these first three, intramembranous ossification is particularly important for the bones of the skull, but pretty much all the rest of the bones of the body, of which there are many, many more, will form through endochondral ossification. Now, as we mentioned at the beginning, endochondral ossification is more complex than intramembranous, and this is all because of the middle step. So you have that mesenchymal skeleton, but then you'll have the inclusion of this cartilage model, which is not only present, it's not only going to form a model, but this model will actually grow before being replaced by bone. And again, almost all bones of the body are going to form through this ossification process. So in the region of the body where the bone is going to form, chemical messages will cause those mesenchymal cells to crowd together, and it's going to form the general shape of the future bone, so that's that mesenchymal skeleton. Then those cells will differentiate into chondroblasts. So you see right here, in the name, you have the blast, so you know it is building something, specifically secreting cartilage extracellular matrix components. Thus, it's producing this cartilage model. And anytime that you see the chondra within, you know we are talking cartilage. All right, so that is always a good hint that something cartilage is involved. This cartilage model is going to be composed of hyaline cartilage. Now, the cool thing is that this cartilage model will actually grow through both interstitial growth, or growth from within, which results in the cartilage model growing in length, as well as appositional growth, meaning growth of the outer surface, so the cartilage model also will grow in width. Eventually, there will be the development of the primary ossification center. And we talked about ossification centers with intramembranous ossification, and this will also occur with endochondral ossification. But since many of the bones that are being formed here are long bones, which will have a diaphysis and epiphysis, there will be multiple ossification centers. So the primary ossification centers are typically the first, and they were typically located in a central location associated with the diaphysis. So it's kind of in this middle portion right here. And as the primary ossification center grows towards the end of the bone, our good friend the osteoclasts will actually begin breaking down some of the middle portions of the bone to start forming the medullary cavity. With time, often around the time of birth, secondary ossification centers will arise at the epiphyses, once an epiphyseal artery kind of enters into the region. And these are going to be referred to as secondary ossification centers. So you can see one here, and you can see one here. As I said, these are often going to start occurring around the time of birth. And eventually the hyaline cartilage model will be completely replaced with bone, except on the ends where there remains articular cartilage. So you still have a remnant of that cartilage model, even into adulthood, with that articular cartilage. But before an individual reaches adulthood, there is going to be that layer of hyaline cartilage in the metaphysis. Remember that epiphyseal plate? And so that is going to allow for lengthwise growth in the diaphysis. All right, so that was intramembranous and endochondral ossification in a nutshell. There are a lot more details regarding these processes. These are actually fairly complex, but I just wanted to focus on the big picture concepts for our purposes here. But before we part, let's make sure we are crystal clear on one concept. And see if you can quickly answer this question. So the question, which type of ossification process includes the formation of a cartilage model? Is it A, endochondral, or B, intramembranous? And I hope after all the details we have covered in this video, you feel pretty confident that A, endochondral, is the correct answer. First off, it has chondra right within its name, and I told you, anytime you see that, I'm automatically think cartilage is involved. So it kind of says it right here in the name. But I also hope you now know that endochondral is the ossification process that has those additional steps of the formation as well as the growth of the cartilage model that the intramembranous ossification does not have. So that is all I have for this video. In the next video, we will delve a bit more into those terms, interstitial and appositional growth. As you review, please do reach out if you have any questions, and have a great rest of your day.